the recognition of skills, the prior learning that migrants already have. It is first important to kind of establish that rather than assume that migrants don't have skills. Because in very many contexts of migration, you have migrants who are overskilled in jobs that they have. So for example, you would have doctors who take on courses of nurses, engineers who take on jobs of as technicians, teachers who take on jobs as drivers. How do countries of destination recognize those skills? What kind of certification is given for recognition of skills learned? The skills discussion in the context of COVID is going to become an even bigger conversation, largely because we have seen economies go into a recession. A lot of migrant workers have been repatriated, have lost their job. There will be changes that will require whole different skill sets. And this is where countries of origin will have to look at how they can ramp up some of their skilling programs, but also to recognize that the jobs might not be there just yet. At the time of the COVID, one of the biggest issues about labor migration that we have seen is this whole issue of unilateralism. And this is a big, big challenge to the GFMD, because we know that countries of origin as well as countries of destination, at least in the context of labor migration, acted unilaterally. There is a working group that is looking at COVID. We will be able to have discussions how do we go back to multilateralism. Migrant workers have lost jobs. And we are talking about millions. We're talking about millions of migrant workers. Many of these workers who have returned have either lost their jobs, have been laid off, have come back without their end of service benefits. Many workers have not been paid their wages. So many of these workers were the single breadwinners of their families. This has a huge impact on the development of families. They bring back nothing with them. As education went online, many migrant worker families did not have the bandwidth that is required for their children to go on an online education platform. Some did not even have a cell phone, you know, an extra cell phone in the family. Many countries of origin had closed their borders, and when they had started these repatriation flights, were bringing in their workers, allowing the workers to return. But part of the condition was that they had to pay for the COVID test. And the COVID test cost something like $100. Migrant workers couldn't pay for that. So there's so many development impacts because of COVID on the lives of migrant workers that governments will have to come together in the GFMD and go away from the business as usual kind of talk. Civil society will be coming with a very strong agenda of calling for partnerships on hard issues. We can't look at soft issues. We can't look at low-hanging fruit. For example, if you take this non-payment of wages, governments can put out a call to all citizens, non-citizens, migrants, kind of thing, to say all those who have not been paid their wages, kind of thing, please, this is the complaint procedure. Civil society can help in the collection of this data. Funds could be established by private sector and government to give immediate relief. The different stakeholders come, develop the processes, discuss of what is the issue and how each stakeholder can contribute to this. We can start looking at devising social protection programs that migrant workers can avail of. If you look at the SDGs, the principle of no one left behind. In the world of work today, I think we run the risk of migrants being that category of people that will be left behind. And I sincerely hope that at this critical juncture of the GFMD, we will see that it is important for us to continue, but to continue in a very real way for migrants. Never before have we been challenged in everything that we do to put migrants at the center of it all. Now, more than ever, we have to make that our starting point. And this year's GFMD has to rise up to that occasion.